For many of the 63 years of my life to this point, there has been a tension that has existed. Perhaps that tension began when I was 10 years of age and we moved to a farm in Central Texas, and because of my father's disabilities, I was the one who, being the oldest son in the family, had to take upon himself the responsibility of operating all the farm machinery. There was a field to be plowed. I was the one who drove the tractor and plowed the field. If there was a crop to be harvested, I was the one who drove the machinery that did this. And my father was one of those individuals who was prone to not think that there ought to be any idle time living on a farm. And if he ever walked up on me sitting down thinking about something, he would ask me what I was doing. And I might say, well, I was just thinking about such and such. And he would say, son, I'm not paying you to think. At one point in my life, I got bold enough to tell him, Dad, you're not paying me anyway. And he said, you put your feet under Mom's table, don't you? I said, yes, sir. And you wear clothes that we have bought you, don't you? And I said, yes, sir. And he said, that's your pay. But there was this tension that existed, that somehow, you know, if I wasn't doing something, if my hands were not laid to a task, then I was wasting time. Perhaps that was reinforced when I was in college and working at what was then a buddy's grocery store in Brownwood, Texas, and we had a store manager who was of German descent, and he had quite a work ethic himself. And all of us guys that were employed at the store were employed as stockers, as baggers, and folks who carried the groceries out, and even checkers when we were needed. And I remember on an occasion or two when I was stocking a shelf, and I would stop there and I'd think, you know, the way this stock has been moving, we ought to make more room for this particular item than what we've had. And while I was thinking, he would come along and he would ask what I was doing. And once again, when I said, well, I was thinking about, he would say, son, I'm not paying you to think. I carried some of that same tension into my ministry. There was always this attitude that there's just not enough time, there are too many things to do, and there is never enough time. And so I found it very difficult to give in to the other side of that tension that said, I needed to spend some time alone with God. I want to share two or three readings with you this morning from a book that I commend to you. It's titled A Guide to Prayer for All God's People. I think that some of our faculty members perhaps have used this in the past. Here is one of those readings that touches me because of that tension that even to this day to some extent exists in my life. Contemplation does not lead to inactivity. It is in itself the highest actuality of our being. In its compassion, it leads to the deepest concern and the fullest activity according to our particular vocations for the well-being of the entire family, human family, and its global environment. One cannot steadily see the created reality in the face of the loving and compassionate Father and not be transformed and transforming. Another of these. Now, the fathers of the church well understood the importance of a certain holy leisure, otium sanctum. We cannot give ourselves to spiritual things if we're always swept off our feet by a multitude of external activities. Busyness is not the supreme virtue. And sanctity is not measured by the amount of work we accomplish. Perfection is found in the purity of our love for God, and this pure love is a delicate plant that grows best where there's plenty of time for it to mature. One last reading. Maxie Dunham, I believe a pastor coming from the Methodist tradition, once asked Metropolitan Bloom to define the term contemplation. He responded, "Well, I think this is where contemplation begins. Sit and listen. In religious terms, it may be called waiting on God, but it's simply plain listening or looking in order to hear and to understand. If we did that with regard to the Word of God, with regard to the prayers of the saints, with regard to the situations in which we are, to everything people say to us or what they are in life, with regard to our own selves, we would be in that condition which one can call contemplation, which consists in pondering, thinking deeply, in waiting until one has understood in order to act. The inaction would be much more efficient, less hasty, and filled probably with some amount of the divine wisdom." Dunham said, now that's a clear definition, but he said he made it even clearer by this nursery rhyme that he had learned while in the United States. A wise old owl lived in an oak. The more he saw, the less he spoke. The less he spoke, the more he heard. Why can't we be like that old bird? You may have people in your church who would be inclined to say to you, "We don't pay you to think." But I would say to you that our Lord says, Thinking, and praying will pay the greatest dividends in your ministry.